In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I truly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask you pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. We had just celebrated Divine Mercy Sunday. That's a relatively new celebration, or new, shall we say, assignment of the second Sunday of Easter to that particular, shall we say, thought, particular mystery even. Divine Mercy. As we were considering yesterday, it was the express desire of St. John Paul II to put that in the calendar, the liturgical calendar. A reflection, most probably, of his own devotion, for not to say a devotion which is popular in Poland, having started there, I think, to the merciful heart of Jesus, to the divine mercy. Because we had considered so many times in the course of these meditations, that's the characteristic quality of the love of God for us. What we would even say is the terms of engagement of our relationship with God. In the natural plane, we're creatures. He is the creator, we're creatures. But in the supernatural plane, he is the forgiving, the merciful, the loving God. And we're penitential, we're sorry, we're almost ashamed of our own woundedness, but at the same time, relying on our divine filiation that we're his children, we never get tired of saying sorry. Or at least we should not, as he himself never gets tired of forgiving us. So that's Divine Mercy Sunday. And now the day after, we celebrate the Feast of St. Mark. A saint who is not very well known, I think, despite the fact that he's one of the four evangelists, together with St. Matthew, Luke, and St. John. He's the fourth evangelist, providing us with the shortest gospel, but so concise, but at the same time so observant that he has certain details that the others missed. Who was St. Mark? And why is it so fitting that we celebrate his, shall we say, feast precisely the day after Divine Mercy Sunday? Sacred Scripture relates how St. Peter, after having been freed from jail by the ministry of an angel in Jerusalem, it says there that Peter went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose other name was Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. It's the first time that Scripture mentions the name of Mark. Further on, it tells us that he accompanied Paul and Barnabas on their first apostolic journey, that he abandoned them in Cyprus, that island there, and that for this reason, St. Paul did not allow him to go with them on their second journey. John was relatively young. And one can understand why at the face of the apostolic journey of St. Paul, that he stayed behind in Cyprus. Most probably he got tired, he got afraid, or he just plain felt homesick, having left his mother in Jerusalem. But whatever reason it was, during the first apostolic journey of St. Paul, in which John Mark was part, he flaked off. That's the first note that we have of St. Mark. He was the disciple who did not finish the first apostolic journey. One has to understand those apostolic journeys of St. Paul. He made three. A journey that would take him over the whole of the Mediterranean, through all the Greek, the Roman, the Greco-Roman cities, making use of the system of of shipping system of the Romans, the roads. One of those things that one is amazed that even in that divine providence made use of something which was put up there by the Romans in order to serve the legions, in order to subdue the world, in order to impose their rule over the whole of the civilized world, then became the instrument by which divine providence has spread the good news. Thanks to those roads, thanks to that peace, thanks to the shipping lanes, Christianity spread throughout the empire quite fast, so that after three centuries, the whole of the Roman Empire was already Christianized, especially with the conversion of the emperor himself, Constantine. Well, it's nice to read about that in the Acts of the Apostles, until one makes what in Spanish we call composición de lugar. No, we make our own composition of time and place and space, and then you realize that it was no mean feat to make that trip. And to make it in the time span that they made it, a couple of years, hardly, through all those. And it's not as if they were like nowadays when somebody goes in a cruise, so comfortable and so fast. No, remember that they were not going around to tour. They were going around to spread the good news. So in each place, therefore, they had to stay for not only days, but weeks in order to evangelize, in order to baptize, to convert, in order to leave behind some kind of leadership to continue the work. It was not just sowing the good seed, but making sure that it germinates and it's protected so that it can grow and not be obliterated at first, shall we say, resistance, at first difficulty. So those trips, those so-called apostolic trips of St. Paul, were humongous operations. And so for a young man like Barnabas, or rather like St. John Mark or John Mark, to kind of flake off, is quite understandable. How about us? And this is the first spiritual, shall we say, sense, after getting the literal sense of just going around, looking at the itinerary, looking at the map. Now we go to the spiritual sense of spreading the good news, of spreading the gospel. What must have fired St. Paul to do that? And his companion, Barnabas, and for a while, even John Mark, despite his youth. It's not easy to understand the kind of apostolic drive that those people had. The same apostolic drive that later on, centuries later, the missionaries, like the Spanish friars, for example, that came to these shores, so often misrepresented, so often vilified and demonized, as if, you know, this bunch of friars come here to enjoy themselves in paradise. Paradise? Philippines was not a paradise. Philippines is a tropical rainforest, and for a European at that time, before the development of the islands, this was a hellhole, so to speak. It's nice to look at the Philippines when you look at the beaches, but if you look, you go to the rainforest, which is where they went. Nowadays, we find cities and roads, but before that, all of these were rainforests. And that was the kind of territory that those friars had to evangelize. Those were the natives, like the Tasadais that we have known, that they had to educate and bring down from their culture of slash and burn, or just gathering, to teach them agriculture in order to bring them to an urbanized setting, because that was the only way they could be evangelized. Or la sombra della campanilla, under the shade or the shadow of the belfry. That was the goal. And that's the reason why in every town, any municipality, not only in the Philippines, but in South America and in Mexico, you will find the same pattern. But on the other hand, it's the pattern of the towns in Spain. You have a town square, and a rectangle or a square. On one end, you will have the church, and on the opposite end, you will have the ayuntamiento, the city hall, or the municipal hall, and on either side, shops. And then from there, radiate the streets for people to settle down. And then outside of that, the agricultural lands that have become, shall we say, agriculture and not just gathering or not just forests. Well, St. Paul didn't have to do anything like that because the cities were already established by the Romans. This was Europe. But he had to travel, and to travel a lot, and he had to contend with diseases, the seasons, provide for himself because he never lived off anybody. If he settled long in a place, then he exercised his profession. He was a tent maker. But as I said at the beginning, what fired him to do that was the great love for Jesus Christ. Loving Christ because of realizing how much he had been loved and forgiven and understood by Jesus Christ, that love overflows to wanting to share, because bonum est diffusivum sui, the good by itself is diffusive. When you discover something good, you want to share it. And this is the reason why when you discover, or I don't know, the means of formation, that there are good recollections here, there's good confessional schedule here, or there's these meditations that you can get in YouTube. But then you tell a relative, you tell a friend. And that's how the subscription to these meditations has grown through the months and the years. It should grow more. Because people need this food. The other day, I was talking with a lawyer, 70 plus years old already, retired. He says he still goes to office to talk with their senior clients, although most of the businesses are run by the second generation already. But anyway, as soon as we met each other, it was a gathering, a family affair. He immediately told me that, congratulating me for what I was doing on TV. I thought he referred to an interview that JMA7 had done a couple of months ago regarding the divorce bill. I thought he was referring to that. And I was a bit apologetic of how the thing turned out. But then I was even kind of consoling him and consoling myself with the thought that even if they use a small percentage of the air time, or rather the shall we say, the footage that I give them, even bending it many times to the narrative that they want, the fact remains that a lot of that is kept on file, and years, even decades afterwards, I'm just surprised when somebody says that they saw me on TV on this discussion or that discussion. Well, depending on what the issue is, they have something on file there that they had interviewed me about. But that wasn't what he was referring to. After a little bit more of conversation, I realized he was referring to these meditations. I got misled because I said TV, and this is not on TV, right? But anyway, he's a senior citizen, and for him it's the same whether it's TV or YouTube. It's still coming out in the monitor there in their living room. We share the good that we discover. And that's what drove St. Paul to make those missionary journeys, not just once, not just twice, but three times. But poor St. Mark, the first time he flaked off. Mark did not form a part of the group of the apostles, but he was a disciple of the first hour. He accompanied them in their apostolic endeavors and gradually became one of the most faithful collaborators, especially of St. Peter. St. Jerome would write a few facts which shed light on what his life was like. And I quote, "Mark, disciple and interpreter of Peter, at the request of the brethren who lived in Rome, put his gospel into writing according to what he had heard Peter preaching. Peter himself approved it. After having listened to it, and he handed it over with his authority so that it might be read in the church. Because that's what happened. In much the same way that Barnabas and Timothy became the sidekicks of St. Paul, the intrepid St. Paul, the energetic St. Paul, the tireless St. Paul. Well, Mark was the, and together with St. Luke became the sidekicks of St. Peter. Peter did not write much. He wrote two or three letters, I think, two. But he preached a lot. In the Acts of the Apostles, we read how, even in Jerusalem, but also in Rome, he would deliver those long discourses, so fiery. You get a glimpse of that in that old film, Quo Vadis. No? You find him there preaching exactly the words that you read in Acts of the Apostles. So fiery that after the sermon, it says there that 5,000 souls were added to the roster of the church of the early Christians. The conversion of 5,000 just after listening to Peter. Well, that was just one day's work. And imagine, he kept at it for days and weeks and months. And Mark was there listening, and St. Luke too. Aside from the fact that St. Luke also got close to Our Lady. And so this is how the evangelist learned of the facts of the things that our Lord did and said. Aside from the fact, as I said, that Mark also was there, a disciple of the first hour. He knew our Lord personally. He heard our Lord personally, but he heard more of what our Lord said when, in those occasions that he wasn't around, and that would be many, because the inner circle, the 12 apostles, they were always with our Lord for the span of almost 2 years, rather more than 2 years, that they heard a lot. Well, because of the things that they heard from Peter, Mark wrote his gospel. And after reading it to Peter, then Peter approved it. And it started to be read in the churches. And St. Jerome continues. Afterwards, taking the gospel he had written, Mark went off to Egypt and announced Christ for the first time in Alexandria. He thereby founded the church there with so much doctrine and right living that by his example, he drew many to follow Christ. And this is the second point. The first was the love of God, the love of Christ overflows to wanting to transmit it. And the second point is this. No amount of eloquence can bring people to a conversion like, especially when they know that conversion would bring them at odds with the existing authority, the Romans, who demanded that everyone in the empire, reverence and pay public homage and cult to the Roman gods, at least publicly, at least externally. And the Christians didn't even want to do that, not even just to comply with the civil law, the civil regulation, the civil disposition for all the subjects of the empire to do that. And yet they were converted. What converted them? And here, St. Jerome says, is the exemplarity of the lives of those who were preaching the good news. In other words, they walked the talk. And that's why they were convincing. They were preaching the good news. First of all, a set of doctrines about who God is, about the Blessed Trinity, about God made man, about his great love for mankind, about the sacraments, the channels of salvation, of grace, rather, for the salvation of mankind, all of which made sense, a lot better sense, more sense than all the things that they had heard so far with their paganism, with their esoteric religions even. And that's the reason why, the first reason why they were converted, the doctrine being taught. But most of all, the exemplarity of the life of those who were preaching. They walked the talk. Unlike the case of the elders, the scribes, and the Pharisees of the Jews, who did not, shall we say, walk the talk, who many times, as our Lord himself said, no, listen to what they're saying, but don't follow what they're doing, because they're not doing what they're preaching. And that's the reason why they had to complicate the Ten Commandments into 613 precepts. Details, nitty-gritty, that took the attention away from the essentials of the Ten Commandments, because precisely they were failing in them. Can you imagine the commandment to keep the Sabbath holy? Keep the Sabbath holy. I mean, that's very simple, right? Keep the Sabbath holy. Be centered on God. Pay him public and private cult on that day. Don't commit sin. Be exemplary in your ethics, in your morality on that day. And that's what that means. And yet they got into the casuistry of, you know, so therefore how much work, you shouldn't work, but then you need to work a little because you need to eat, you need to feed the animals, etc. So how then started computing how much work you needed to do, the minimum, in order to fulfill your obligations, and all kinds of cash restraint. Well, the disciples of our Lord, the evangelists and the apostles, they walked the talk. And therefore, they attracted people. Or better said, by incarnating the personality of our Lord Jesus Christ, by becoming Christ himself, then as Christ said, when I'm lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. I will draw all things to myself. And if one incarnates Christ because of the holiness of his life, then effectively Christ is lifted up wherever a Christian is, and he will take care of drawing people to himself. We cannot, shall we say, disguise the personality, the image of Christ that should be shining through our poor human flesh. The greatest insult, the greatest scandal, the greatest reason why people do not get converted, or if they're already Catholics, they do not live a radical Christianity, a radical following of Christ, because they haven't seen anyone do it. The ideal of sanctity in the middle of the world, the ideal of being identified with Christ, of being a contemplative in the middle of the world, in the middle of all the ordinary tasks, remains an ideal for many, because precisely they haven't seen anybody do that. And that's what you and I have to do. The first apostolate that we can do is the apostolate of good example. Is to provide people with that proof that the ideal of the gospel is not just a highfalutin ideal, as they would say, but is a reality that we're trying to live on a daily basis. Definitely imperfectly, because there's nobody perfect in this side of the grave. But yes, honestly trying, effectively struggling, on a track that's going to heaven, even if there are pitfalls along the way, even if we might get lost a bit right or left along the way, but we have a course and we're following it. And that's what St. Mark did. Despite that original debacle of getting left behind in Cyprus, the fact of the matter is afterwards he recovered. He did not consider himself a loser and just get lost. From bad to worse, he became the disciple of Peter, precisely. And later on, he wrote the gospel. How true it was, or it is, you know, what Pope Francis says it. But even before him, St. John Paul II said it already. And Pope Benedict XVI said it too. That every saint has a past, and every sinner has a future. Let's never get tired of our woundedness. Let's never get tired of our failures. Rather, let's keep our eyes on the Master, our Lord, who keeps on saying, come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. What time frame? When? Only he knows that. What is under our control is our following him. Come, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. He will be the one to make us fishers of men. We are the ones who will follow him. So let's do that. Let's follow him. And that's what we have been trying to do all these days. In the crossing of the desert, all the days of Lent, and then falling in love, being touched by that love of God. No greater love than that, that to lay his life for his friends. Now, as we prepare for Pentecost, let's continue getting amazed by that love. The way that St. Mark must have been so amazed by that, shall we say, love that he saw oozing out of the pores of that intrepid apostle, St. Paul. We have to end. What are we going to do on a day like today? What kind of resolution can we make? Well, first, off the head, from the top of my head that comes is, what learning from the example of St. Mark of never saying enough, never getting discouraged if at first try we don't succeed. He failed in the first missionary journey. He wasn't able to join the second and the third of St. Paul, but he joined Peter. With Peter, nothing can possibly go wrong. Ubi Petrus, ibi Ecclesia, ibi Deus. Where Peter is, there is the church. There is God. That's the first lesson. And second, it's the apostolic dimension. The apostolic, shall we say, projection of that conviction of the love of God. Because we have felt that love. And we see how good that thing is. Then we want to share it. And we can never get tired just because people do not respond or the times are difficult, etc., etc. Well, if the Spanish friars would have thought that, the hard-headedness of the natives at first, the difficulty, the environment, the malaria and all kinds of tropical diseases that they were not used to and they were not immune to because they were coming from a different environment, then we would still be pagans at this stage. For not to say we might have become Muslims most probably because the Islam was coming from the south, going upwards. When Legazpi came to Manila, the Sultan was already Muslim. Raja Suleiman was a Muslim, and his uncle too. Well, you and I would have become Muslims. But no, because they persevered, because they did apostolate, because they continue with the work of evangelization, we are here, the vanguard of the gospel in the Orient. Let's never take that for granted. You have a few minutes left to concretize your resolutions and end this time of prayer.